This week we're talking about words, and I love the first video. I love both of them, but the first video when that very serious teacher, I was talking about the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. I grew up with teachers like that, but she makes some excellent points. And when I was getting dressed this morning, I thought I'd wear my flamingo shirt because I like flamingos, and I use flamingo pink nail polish when I do my nails, which hasn't been since February. And I'm thinking, well, what's the color of flamingo? I've seen flamingos. Sometimes they're pink, sometimes they're orange, sometimes they're such a light white that you barely see any like pop of color. So this shirt indicates it. So I have a flamingo pink. Well, what is it? Is it this color or this color? I have another newsflash. I can't see color out of one of my eyes. And so I have black and white in one eye and color in the other. So I have to squint because I have sunglasses on now. But it's so funny about colors. When I built a house years ago, and I'm the boss, and I decide what colors I want inside my home, I said, I know I want white trim. I want everything to be in white trim. It's clean, it's neat, I love it. And then my contractor said, well, what color white would you like, Miss Fernandes? And I'm like, what do you mean, what color white? White is white. He said, no, it's not. And then he brought me all these paint samples from Benjamin Moore. And there was linen white, there was snow white, there was cloud white, there was super white, and then there was dove white. But there was even more than that. And I think I stopped at about five of them and said, I'm gonna just pick one of these. This is well too overwhelming. And then I picked dove white because doves meant peace. So that's what that video is trying to say. What is influencing us? Is it the name or the experience? Which comes first? So words really do make a difference. What you call people, the titles, right? People get title driven. Some people do. They're a Ms., they're a Mrs., they're a Mr., they're a doctor, they're a professor. It can really be to the point where you're thinking, I thought that 7% of our conversations were only verbal and the rest were 38 and 58% for vocal and visual, when words really do matter. Yes, they do. The names of your children, right? You names for the ear, you want a nice sound. You probably took your last name, and when you would think of a first name, how is it gonna sound together? Maybe the names were symbolic because you were honoring somebody in the past, like a grandparent or something, but the name was significant. And then the nickname, is there gonna be a nickname? And who's calling that person that name? I noticed in my family, I am called, my first name is Joyce, but I don't think anyone calls me Joyce. I can't think of one person that does. They call me Annie, because that's my middle name. I've been Annie and Anna Banana for a long time. I get called Joyce, which is my brother's version of Joyce in French, because we were influenced like by a lot of French communities growing up in Fall River. And I just get called all these different names. I have my boyfriend calls me his sweet babu. He calls me Babu. I call him Babu. And sometimes he's my semi-sweet Babu or my sweet and sour Babu. Right. So it's like names are very specific to the relationship. And that goes going back to my boyfriend of 27 years. It's interesting to see what people want to call him. Names put people in categories, so we think that's neat and tidy. His sister forever has called me his fiance. I'm not his fiance, but that's a name. That's a word she's comfortable with, so it's fine. Debbie says I'm Jeffrey's fiance, and I say, okay. Other people call me his wife, and he's my husband, and that makes them feel comfortable. It's not true, but that's okay. And others say, oh, he's your significant other, or he's your partner, but there seems to be no word for it. I call him my boyfriend, and someone said, you can't be 64 years old and have a 66-year-old boyfriend. That sounds ridiculous. Like, what is it to you? But words do matter. So you might find this in your own relationships, that we are all like surrounded by the power of words. When people started putting tattoos on their bodies with lots of words, scriptures, song titles, I was like, I remember one time being at a bar, I think it was Antonio's in New Bedford, waiting for my shrimp Mozambique, and I was reading someone's arm. And I caught myself reading, and I know that's like rude, but there's the arm, there's the words, and I like to read. And he saw me reading it. He said, oh, you're reading, that's scripture. And he's telling me where it came from, the Bible. And I said, well, it's lovely. And I said, but that's interesting, you have words on you, not just a symbol. And this was quite a while ago, maybe 25, 30 years ago. Now you see it more often. He said, well, those words mean something to me. And I wanted them there, even though I can't read them off my own arm. but they're significant to me, so I put them on there. I thought that was interesting. Especially my teacher friends say, that generation who have language on their arms, tattoos, they don't like to read a book, but they think someone's going to read their arm. But it's words, right? I shop in different gift shops, at least I used to. Even just going to TJ Maxx or Marshall's, and you go to the giftware department, and you started seeing like words, like relax, breathe, hope. You know, you see little rocks in the garden with one word on them. And those words were significant. I have breathe. I have breathe in my office. I have relax and breathe in my office. Just words on pieces of wood that's, you know, decorated a little bit. And they're just up there. And it's just the words. So it has some significance to me. If any of you, and I know you, and there are, people know more than one language, you understand that learning a language is an intellectual experience, an emotional experience, a spiritual experience. Because you're learning about what means something, their value system, when you learn what words they have, what values do they have. You know, we don't have a word for a 27-year relationship. We don't have a word for that. So, but we don't have, some cultures don't have a word for nursing home because they would never have a nursing home. So they don't have the word. So which comes first? But learning a language, it really does expand your perspectives, your appreciation of your own language, and more words, right? When I first started understanding in the Portuguese language that they use the word sweetheart all the time, they call you querida, I think. My pronunciation is probably really bad, but querida, querida. And I thought, how lovely that that word is used like that, and it's such an endearing word, part of their language, right? Shady in our class, he knows Arabic, I bet he knows French, he knows English, probably knows three or four other languages as well. Because once you start understanding language's connection and enjoying the words of the language, the syntax, the rapport you build, you start to be open to more languages. It's just what happens, right? The more we know, the more we can know. And I really believe that's true. So this is Monday. I'm putting it up there because I am now saying I have to, I'm starting to feel so disconnected from all my classes. And this summer, I did not feel that way. And I'm not sure why. It was different groups that I was watching there. I just didn't feel the same way. I didn't really connect to them any more than I'm connecting to my classes this semester. But I'm starting to feel the power of this pandemic taking over, and I'm trying to resist it. And I do believe you can experience more than one emotion at different ends of the spectrum. I'm still heartbroken what's happening in this country, what's happening to my students that we're not in class. I'm heartbroken. For the first 2 months of this pandemic, for the first 2 months, March, April, and May, that's 3 months, I woke up with tears in my eyes. I cried every day. I could not get a handle on it. And yet I was joyful and optimistic and hopeful and really trying to be strong for everyone around me, saying, you wear your mask, you do social distancing, you wash your hands, you don't go into crowds. You have to protect yourself and your group, right? Your peers, your thous, and be good role models so that we can get through this, right? All together, healthy, and donate your time, go to the food drives, but be smart about it, exactly, right? I have my PPE, I have shields, I have masks, I even have gowns that I wear when I go into certain circumstances. So I'm very much self-protective and show self-love, but I'm hoping that is a mirror to others to do the same, that's contagious. And so you can feel that fear, dread, anger, and then joy and optimism and gratitude. I am so grateful for you. I'm so grateful for the students at Bristol Community College who are taking a chance with online education. I really am. But I'm very emotional, and it's hard. This is an emotional class talking about relationships. When I read some of your journals, I start to cry. And I don't add my commentary because it's not my business, but I'm so respectful and appreciative of what you're going through. And you're a compassionate group of young people. This summer, I don't know why it was felt different. I don't think any of us thought it was going to keep going. I thought we had great optimism that by the end of August, September, life would be back to normal. And now reality is, it's like, it's not. But what is normal? Of course, that's another word we can talk about, right? Everyone has a different definition or social construction of that. There were things that were happening socially, economically, spiritually, financially in our country that were wrong and that needed to be corrected. This is a great opportunity. Hopefully we don't miss the mark and we do make a change. Ruth Bader Ginsburg just passed away. She's definitely one of my role models. And I was so appreciative of her findings, what she said, what she wrote, what she did, that she exercised all the time, that she stood up for women. She stood up for all people. She really didn't think that this country would be even close to being what the founding fathers predicted until we had equal opportunity for everybody, that we weren't fearful of populations or groups. Years ago, they predicted, the actuaries or the sociologists said that by 2050, there would be more Spanish being spoken in this country than English. Well, I say, hola, learn Spanish. That didn't threaten me, but for some people it did and still does. That we're going to be changing, but we're always going to be human, and so that's the good part. And you have a strong constitution and you'll be fine. So I know that this COVID-19 has turned our world upside down and that it can be very confusing, but please find joy. Do things to trick yourself into being happy. I go for walks, I still go to the ocean, and I am selective who I spend time with at a distance, and socially correct. But I don't miss out on opportunities to show people that I love them, to listen to others. Anyway, I'm gonna do this again, over and over again, until you say no more videos, Ms. Fernandes. But I want you to take time to watch those two videos, participate in the discussion board, and then at the end of the week, I'll discuss more, because there was a lot of content in them that I want to review with you for your edification and your support of your humanities communication education. All right, take care, everyone.